seat especially in the metropolitan areas. Most of our metropolitan areas or countries are in Gauteng. Tshwane, Johannesburg, Ekurhuleni, Elmwood, we go to Nelson Mandela, and then Buffalo City, and the Free State, which is coming, Bloemfontein in the Free State, then HMV. So those are the metros that we used to cover, but those in Gauteng, we didn't win them in negotiations for parties were not successful. So when it comes to local councils, we don't control the metropolitan areas in Gauteng. In fact, if you can imagine that we are being thrown into the benefit of the rural areas. That is the situation. I'm just going to discuss our issue so that you get a sense of what MEC controls and what it doesn't control. So that when we deal with what we are doing currently, there is an idea, a pitch of what we are trying to resolve. In Pamalang, today, we are controlling that metropolitan by one vote. And then and those are the only two Pamalang and Buffalo City are the only two metros that we won outside. But those in Pamalang is by one vote. And then in Pamalang, we went into a coalition negotiation, so we want to, as a coalition government, in the step of, okay. But now, what has happened is that we have been experiencing both political and economic challenges. Let us say social, political, and economic challenges in South Africa. And the decline of the ANC has been there, but it has been very marginal. For the first time, we got quite serious in 2021. But it is because of the challenges that we have been dealing with internally as the organization and others, social and economic. As we know, South Africa has about 60 million people. We just completed our census and the formal report will be issued out quite soon. Part of the challenge, despite the fact that South Africa has been led by the ANC since 1994, it has built more than 4 million houses. It has electrified almost above 90% of the country. It has provided water to households almost above 80%. It has put in massive urban infrastructure. It has a modern road infrastructure. Despite those things that the ANC has done, there has also been a deterioration of service delivery. There has also been a challenge with regards to all these were almost there, and the ANC then adopted a program of unity and renewal. Because there has been some challenges of coherence within the African National Congress, and because we are the oldest liberation movement in the continent, yes, you can't clear that the ACDF to renew itself. Hence, the program of unity and renewal. Now, the starting point of the renewal program, as you would know, every organization can only renew itself in two areas. Structurally, the quality of the hardware level and at the software level. So we then started off that process of renewal at the structural level. We didn't change our structural outlook, but the focus was on the membership system. We moved from the manual membership system to the electronic online membership system. Our comrades, you must not expect us to listen to you when that is starting. You shouldn't expect that respect. We will see more of it. Yeah, let's deal with the issue of interpretation of this. Now, we're starting off the renewal program at a hardware level. It was at the hardware level of any organization. We focus on the structure, we focus on the membership, we focus on the constitution, we focus on the processes, the systems. Those are your organizational hardware. With regards to membership, we have put an electronic system in place. You'll remember that the ANC membership for the first time in its history, the ANC was able to register above 1 million members. In 2012, it was about 1.7 million members. So there is this experience in managing such a huge membership in the country was really challenging. Hence, we needed an online system or electronic system. But it was also addressing the weaknesses that we found in the system of manipulation of our democratic processes and membership, especially towards conferences. So that process was started, it took about 3 years. The functionality of the system is at about 80%. So that is why some of the optics, visuals that you see in the country when there are conferences and so on, it is because there are still gaps that still need to be addressed at the membership level. But part of the new one also involves the selection and election of leaders. For an example, the ANC, the structures, the BCs, the structures, leadership at various levels used to dictate, used to have almost a blank check in determining who has to be the mayor, who has to be the premier, and so on. So it is the structures that decide that. But when it comes to local municipalities, a grand general meeting takes place, and once it has taken place, the people in the wards have to be the one that decides who must be the ward council. And when it comes to mayors, the structure has to give 3 legs, and the provincial leadership has to intervene. Those days. When it comes to metros, the mayors at the metropolitan level, and the premiers, when the constitution has always required that the province can make a recommendation of 3 days. But now, we have gone beyond just a recommendation. To submit to the province 3 days to the NEC, then the NEC sends a panel for those mayors to be interviewed. So this is part of the world, because this is part of a shortcoming or the source of problems that we had that bled the integrity of the ANC. Now, to establish a judicial commission of inquiry, it was not an easy decision. It's a decision that emanated out of a serious outcry from both within the ANC and from society, that the ANC is complicit in corruption, because there were corrupt activities that were taking place. So we set up a judicial commission following the conference resolution in 2017, what is called the Zondo Commission. And now that commission has been completed, and the reports have just started. I think we are about to be to get the final report of the Solar Commission. It has not been an easy process for the ANC because it has also been embarrassed, it has tested the resilience of the ANC. But it is a decision that we took as a conference where, in some instances, the optics were quite valid, but leaders of the ANC, you know, have to justify what they are accused and so on. And that report is not quite kind to the ANC. Now, and that report comes within the context of the dwindling economy, the economy is underperforming. Prior to COVID-19, the levels of unemployment were just oscillating between 5% and 27%. And if you look at the labor force of South Africa, it's just almost under 35 million, with a population of 60 million. And now, if the levels of unemployment, and this is your, what's the name, quality economics, limited definition, what's it? I forgot there's a term for, that former definition of 7%. If you were to look at the expanded definition of unemployment at that time before COVID, it would go just over 30%. And young people are the ones who are facing the brunt of high levels of unemployment in South Africa. That is why, in South Africa, for some time, I have been experiencing community protests day in, day out. I think even now, there should be a community somewhere that is having a protest of some kind. This is because of the levels of unemployment. I know many people think that South Africa is the working land of making money. It is not easy, it is tough for South Africans. So I'm making this picture so that there is appreciation of why we come to sessions like this and why we like to share with our fellow comrades on issues on how to better lives for our people. So renewal also is about a program that we call radical social economic transformation. In other words, to deal with these economic misfortunes in a very strategic way. And COVID has actually brought the salt to already the bleeding wound of the country. So it has not been easy. Levels of unemployment have gone quite more high. And we now have to come up with the economic recovery and rebuilding. And that program is underway. The president has taken almost what you could say a change of one, where we massify infrastructure building of our country to ensure that we create more work for young people. We want South Africa to come back to, you know, President Bill was called in 2010 or so, a construction site. And we can see that Tanzania, especially the road between Kiva and Dar es Salaam, we can say it is also a construction site. So we want to get to that point. There's a lot of work that is being done on the economic front, but part of what is being done also is to ensure that we deal with our energy challenges. So there has been a process of mixing the energy grid to resolve our ESCOM and various states.
Maybe a fire prevention.
What is the fire prevention?
Kwa mfupi nizungumzie historia ya CCM. Muundo wake pamoja na baadhi ya vitu kisha kutoa changamoto na maoni. Sì, siamo.
Sì, siamo.
Ok, siamo, c'è un problema. Mi ci muovo la piano di lui, in cui abbiamo così.
Sì, siamo.
Ciao, ciao, la ciao, ciao,
CCM was formed through the combination of two parties, China UFAs and ASP.
CCM was formed
It was founded on the 5th of February 1977.
CCM was formed in Dodoma.
The headquarters is in Dodoma.
Lakini ina ofisi ndogo ya makao makuu Dar es
Salaam. Have a sub-group headquarters in Dar es Salaam, Zanzibar.
Lakini pia ina muundo wa kiongozi kuanzia ngazi ya shina, tawi, kata, jimbo, wilaya na ngazi ya taifa.
The entire structure from the branch level, the district level, regional level, national level.
CCM in a mundo wa vikao.
CCM has a structure of meetings.
Katika ngazi ya chini, kuanzia ngazi ya shina.
At its lowest level, they have a community, leadership committee.
Lakini katika ngazi zingine kuanzia ngazi ya tawi mpaka mkoa, structure yake ya uongozi inaanzia ngazi ya secretariat, kamati ya siasa, halmashauri kuu na mkutano.
From the branch level all the way to the regional level, it has the secretariat. At the national level, they have a special committee on the side of Zanzibar. We have the secretariat. We have the committee for security. We have the central committee. We have the general meeting.
Halmashauri kuu na mkutano. Lakini pia tuna organization ya chama.
We have the organization of the party.
Ambayo inajumuisha jumuiya za chama.
Which combines all the branches of the party.
Kuna jumuiya ya vijana.
We have the women wing.
Kuna jumuiya ya wanawake.
We have the We also have the section for the parents. We have a structured leadership. In our country, the chairperson for CCM, who is also the president of the Republic of Tanzania is the one who chairs CCM. And the president of Zanzibar becomes the deputy chairperson. And we also have the deputy chairperson on Tanzania mainland, who is mostly former Secretary General of CCM. And now we have the deputy chairperson, Comrade Abdul Rahman Kinana.
Tunaye katibu mkuu wa CCM.
avrei dovuto dare un punto di facciata.
We also have the Secretary General for CCM.
Mi ha detto una maniera di fare
We also have Deputy Secretary General in Tanzania mainland as well as Zanzibar. We have 4 departments under the Secretary General's office. We have the department that deals with international relations, as we call it, as we abbreviate SUKI. International Political
Affairs.
We have organization. We also have the department that deals with economics. And the Department of Propagation. How then has CCM managed to be in power until this day? One of the reasons that our CCM interest is because of its
policy. We
evaluate our policy after every election. Whether or not this based on the needs. And that's why we do have a document that we have a manifesto, a manifesto. The second reason why CCM is still in power is its general structure. You may have heard of the previously said that we have structures and leadership from the grassroots, that is the branch level. And this is what makes the system what it is. The third thing is research. So we have the youth from different universities to conduct research, also monitoring and evaluation, and from that we draw our report. It's how we run the project. We have the ethics. We also have a true democracy. Irrespective of the fact that the Constitution states that whoever is president becomes the chairperson, we need to ensure that this person is well learned. Irrespective of all that, we do have challenges.
Okay. wasipigwe historia ya nchi na harakati za ukombozi wa nchi yetu chini ya damu na ACT ya Marsabit.
One of the challenges that we face with the youth is not knowing their own history, especially in the founding of TANU and ASD.
La prima è l'unitario, la maggiore è la tecnologia, ma le scienze e le tecnologie che occupano anche altri.
But also, it's due che sono due tecnologiche advancements around the world.
L'altro,
thirdly,
c'è una molte evidenza.
Economico salve.
La prima è un supremo, ma supongo una terra marmi, una striscia più o meno di composti di più male alla carne.
And the fourth is the Western superpowers trying to force the parties that took part in the liberation out of power.
Pamoja na hayo, tukusanyika hapa kama vyama vya ukombozi kufanya tafakuri kwa sababu viko vyama vingine vilivyoshambuliwa madarakani, na sisi tuko hapa pamoja na kusoma na kufundishwa mambo mbalimbali, lakini ingine kufanya tafakuri na tathmini aina yake mwenyewe. Tunapendana na tunapendana vyama.
We are here today in order to evaluate why we are still present, but also on the way to discuss the ways forward.
Yako maoni na ushauri ambayo tunaweza kutoa kwa pamoja na kuona namna gani.
I have a few recommendations which I believe we can agree to disagree and find a consensus on the way forward.
Moja ni kuandaa mkakati kamili. Tunafanya kitikadi, teknolojia na mkakati.
We need to prepare tablets, the youth, philosophically, technologically, and
strategically. We are here, 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 we are here.
Every political party to conduct an evaluation. After saying that, I wish to thank you for listening to me. And I wish you a good day.
Frelimo, oye.
Oye.
Musaviki, oye.
Oye.
Africa, oye.
Oye.
Bom, nós vamos tentar aqui partilhar o que é a experiência da Frelimo. No que diz respeito à educação, funcionamento e métodos de trabalho. Queremos, em primeiro lugar, agradecer a oportunidade que nos é dada para podermos partilhar o pouco que temos feito para que permaneçamos unidos nos amigos, nos amigos, como o povo. Lembrar às camaradas que o colonialismo português, devido aos seus atos hostis, ao seu comportamento hostil ao povo moçambicano, criou bases para que o povo se rebelasse. Criou bases para que o povo pudesse se organizar e lutar contra o sistema colonial português. Referimos-nos à repressão política, que serviu de base para que surgissem grupos pequenos de moçambicanos que no interior do país não eram dados a oportunidade de se expressarem. Não estão a ouvir? Não estão a traduzir? Obrigada. Não tendo esta oportunidade de se expressarem politicamente no interior de Moçambique, esses quadros, particularmente os intelectuais, tomaram a decisão de se refugiarem aos países vizinhos, tais como África do Sul, Zâmbia e tantos outros países. Estando lá, foram vivendo a realidade desses países. Sentiram que esses países, afinal de contas, tinham a liberdade de expressar. Foi quando eles uniram-se a movimentos. Movimentos de libertação de Moçambique. Referimos-nos aqui ao surgimento da UDIMA, da UNAM e da UNAM. O presidente Júlio Zinheré, apercebendo-se da existência destes grupos em diferentes pontos da África, procurou igual voltar com quem conversou e deu a ideia da necessidade destes movimentos se unirem para que se tornassem mais fortes, e juntos pudessem lutar para libertar essa vida. Foi quando, em 1971, Eduardo Mugabe, na altura, se encontrava a trabalhar nas Nações Unidas dos Estados Unidos da América. Ele fez férias e foi para Moçambique, com o intuito de visitar a família e não só. Aquilo era uma estratégia, porque ele era um político de mão cheia. De lá de Moçambique, ele chegou à Tanzânia. Chegou à Tanzânia em 1961, onde foi recebido pela liderança do IDENA, que já tinha muitos membros e já tinha se instalado aqui em Tanzânia. Esse foi um processo de busca de caminhos para a Dar es Salaam, mundial, o apoio de Jesus e Anel. Une estes três movimentos e, a 25 de junho de 1972, cria-se a PRELIM, como Frente de Libertação de Moçambique. Depois da realização, da conversa e chegada à consciência de que estes três movimentos, de fato, tinham que se unir, realiza-se, ainda aqui em Tanzânia, em 1972, a primeira conferência. A primeira conferência onde foi eleito o presidente Eduardo Mugabe, como primeiro presidente da PRELIM, como vice-presidente, elegeu-se o Luiz Simão. Depois da realização desta primeira conferência, houve necessidade de se preparar o primeiro congresso da PRELIM. O primeiro congresso da PRELIM foi precisamente, realiza-se precisamente para confirmar a união destes três movimentos em um. Onde se confirma também que o presidente Eduardo Mugabe, que é de fato o primeiro presidente da PRELIM, poderia ser chamado vice-presidente, mas são eleitos outros membros que constituíram o comitê central da PRELIM. Não foi um processo fácil, Mas foi um processo que podemos considerar de muito importante na história de Moçambique, porque com o apoio de José Mianella, nós estamos vendo que, de fato, só unidos que podiam conseguir vencer o inimigo comum, que era o sistema colonial português, e não o colono, e não o português como indivíduo. Houve necessidade de Tocasquia de se fazer o trabalho de mobilização para que os moçambicanos, tanto no interior do Moçambique, assim como em Tanzânia, onde existia a sede praticamente da FEMIL, saber o que estava acontecendo. Tínhamos que saber que a única maneira de nos livrarmos do nosso inimigo era pegarmos em armas e lutarmos contra o sistema colonial português. Mas precisavam de serem incluídos também a exército. Nós estávamos preparados ou interessados em combater o português, o cidadão português. O nosso interesse era combater o sistema colonial português. Então, faz esse trabalho de mobilização no interior e no exterior, a fim de distribuir os nossos quadros, mas os outros movimentos aqui presentes, para não perder tempo e enumerar, foram acolhendo os quadros da FELIL em seus países para que melhor se organizasse. Foram facilitados, inclusive, o transporte de armamento que íamos recebendo dos nossos amigos chineses, dos nossos amigos russos, os argelinos. Foram sendo formados para o partido no exterior e depois vieram para Tanzânia, onde foram disseminados os conhecimentos que foram adquiridos fora do país, incluindo o treinamento militar. Foi dessa forma que se cria a escola de Bagamoy, onde os quadros da FELIL e de outros partidos, se calhar em número menor, foram se formando na tentativa de eles se tornarem mais fortes, mais unidos, e com conhecimento argumentado para que levassem a cabo a luta armada de intervenção de Moçambique. Foram se aproximando a outras bases, tais como a base de Comba, foram se aproximando mais para o interior, Moçambique, na fronteira entre Tanzânia e Moçambique, ou província de Cabo Delgado, recebimos a zona de Andanachué, que estava aproximadamente, ou dista aproximadamente 200 km, era para poder transportar o equipamento deve para o interior do país e as mulheres tiveram um grande contributo neste processo de transporte de material deve. Foram muitas estratégias das mulheres da FELIL. Por isso, a mulher da FELIL sempre se envolveu no processo político desde o início da luta armada até ao fim da luta armada. Foram surgindo conflitos que não contribuíram em nada para a desistência da FELIL na luta pelo alcance da independência. Desses conflitos foram surgindo, morre o próprio lugar, a 3 de fevereiro de 1989, assassinado pelos inimigos da independência de Moçambique, mas foram confinados tantos outros que faziam parte da linha da frente. Mas o inimigo era interno. Encontramos o Lando Tramandaro como o principal inimigo da liberdade, porque ele era um reacionário. Enquanto os outros quatro do partido
Dentro se mais com a opção, o camandário lutava contra a via do povo, no sentido contrariar aquilo que eram os ideais da prefeitura. Pensando que o cardeal era um orçamento inteiro. Defendia a lei do camandário, a libertação do cardeal e não a libertação do orçamento de Roma ou a coisa de Zuma ou ele. Mas os padres foram fazendo de tudo para que este se afastasse. Ou afastasse ou tirasse da sua cabeça esse tipo de pensamento. Não sendo possível, foram atribuídas algumas tarefas, tais como de treinamento de iniciantes e no discurso da luta armada. Iam garantindo a segurança nas zonas libertárias. Para começar, nas zonas civis libertárias. Nas zonas civis libertárias que foram surgindo no curso da luta armada, esses milicianos iam garantindo a segurança da população, mas esse lado do mandato achou que fosse uma oportunidade para criar isso de uma área. Mais que os outros se tornaram exigentes, mais reconhecidos do lugar dos que já tinham sido eleitos. Ele manda este grupo que tinha sido formado por ele, desde que o galera já estava para formar. Este é um acabo a onda de assassinato dos guardas. Infelizmente. Mas fomos fazendo de tudo a ver que alcançamos a independência. A partir da independência, havia um curso organizado da Uniforme, forma órgãos que tomam decisões, referimos-nos ao Congresso, ao Comitê Central, que existem os secretariados. Para além do secretariado do Comitê Central, existe um secretariado dos comitês provinciais, dos distritos, dos comitês de zona, existem também os comitês de círculo e existem as reuniões gerais das círculos. E assim como a família se organiza. E para poder resolver esses problemas, a família usa esses órgãos. Senta em fóruns próprios, em sessões específicas, onde discutem a vida do partido, partilham os desafios que existem e encontram soluções lá nesses órgãos. Para dizer que a PRIMO não discute esses assuntos nos órgãos de comunicação social, mas sim em órgãos que já criou. A FENIMO procura a forma de envolver todas as camadas sociais em órgãos de tomada de decisões e, para o efeito, adotou uma estratégia que nós achamos, para nós achamos que é adequada. Criou quotas para a organização da mulher no sindicato, desde 35%. A Associação dos Combatentes da Luta de Proteção Nacional tem a porcentagem ou quota de 18%. A Associação da Juventude Moçambicana tem a quota de 22%. É através dessas quotas que os jovens, os combatentes, as mulheres e os homens são envolvidos nos órgãos de tomada de decisão. Na Assembleia da República, nas Assembleias Provinciais e tantos outros fóruns de tomada de decisão. E para tirar o equívoco dos nossos inimigos que sempre procuram forma de desacreditar a
quando a Angola alcançou a independência do regime colonial português, foi estabelecido naquela altura, o camarada presidente António Augusto Neto disse naquela altura que a nossa luta não estava completa, que a nossa luta só se completaria quando Lourdes è Africa, especialmente na África Austral, nenhum negro subjugado pelos brancos. E nesta altura, o camarada presidente Agostinho Neto estabeleceu no slogan e diretiva do partido a ideia seguinte: na Namíbia, no Zimbábue e na África do Sul está a continuação da nossa luta. Portanto, a nossa luta só se completaria o dia em que a Namíbia estivesse independente, o dia em que o Zimbábue estivesse independente e o dia em que a África do Sul estivesse livre do regime do apartheid. E isso aconteceu e por isso nós nos sentimos muito felizes em estar aqui hoje com os irmãos da SUAPO, com os irmãos da ZANU-PF e com os irmãos da ANC, que são irmãos de luta do MPLA, e o MPLA sente-se muito honrado de ter participado na emancipação desses povos irmãos. Rapidamente, o MPLA é um partido de massas e de quadros, portanto, é um partido com mais de 3 milhões de militantes inscritos e regularmente inscritos que pagam cotas que estão filiados ao partido e, portanto, faz de nós um dos maiores partidos do continente africano em termos de número de militantes. O nosso partido está estruturado por um congresso. E entre os congressos, o órgão máximo do partido é o Comitê Central, que tem um bureau político e este, por sua vez, um secretariado, que é o órgão executivo do partido. O partido tem duas organizações sociais, nomeadamente a OMA, a Organização da Mulher Angolana, e a JMPLA, a Organização Juvenil do Partido. A nível intermédio, o partido a nível, tem comitês provinciais em todas as 8 províncias do país, e, por sua vez, comitês municipais, e, na base, temos comitês comunais ou distritais, dependendo se for o meio urbano ou rural, e depois temos também os comitês de ação, que são as estruturas menores do partido que estão nas comunidades enraizadas. O nosso partido, como disse, é um partido de quadros, mas também é um partido de massas, e, portanto, isso explica a numerosa estrutura militante que o partido tem em todo o país. O nosso país passa por desafios muito significantes. O camarada presidente João Manuel Gonçalves Lourenço está na direção do partido há sensivelmente 5 anos. E, portanto, como deverão imaginar os camaradas, nós estamos num processo de transição e também de transição geracional, da geração que conduziu o partido até a independência nacional, por sua vez, uma outra geração está a fazer o processo de transição. Neste contexto, o partido tomou medidas importantes e estabeleceu como no 8º Congresso, que recentemente terminou, foi realizado em dezembro de 2021, estabeleceu que, como diretiva, o 8º Congresso, no Congresso extraordinário, já havia sido estabelecido, foi confirmado pelo Congresso Ordinário, a paridade do gênero como critério com todos os órgãos do partido e do Estado, enquanto o MPLA tiver o poder. O que quer dizer que 50% de todos os órgãos do partido são compostos por mulheres e 50% dos órgãos do Estado também são compostos por mulheres. Isso inclui a nossa bancada parlamentar na Assembleia Nacional. No processo de rejuvenescimento, também ficou estabelecido que 35% de todos os órgãos do partido deverão ser compostos por indivíduos com menos de 35 anos. Portanto, o processo de rejuvenescimento do partido está em curso. Hoje, 35% dos órgãos do partido estão ocupados por jovens com menos de 35 anos. O nosso país, nos camaradas não saber, continua, como diz aqui, neste processo, na segunda sessão extraordinária do Comitê Central realizada na semana passada, ficou estabelecido que a lista do partido para as eleições gerais que ocorrerão em agosto de 2022 será composta por 50% homens, perdão, 49% homens e 51% mulheres. E quero dizer que para a próxima legislatura nós teremos a vice-presidente da República, será uma mulher, e a presidente da Assembleia Nacional também será uma mulher. Digo também que temos no Tribunal Constitucional da República de Angola 11 juízes conselheiros, dos 11, 7 são mulheres e 4 são homens, incluindo a presidente do Tribunal Constitucional, é uma mulher.
Viva a mulher angolana!
Viva!
Viva a mulher angolana!
Viva!
Isso dito, camaradas, gostava agora rapidamente de abordar o nosso estado atual enquanto nação, enquanto país. E essa era uma importante partilha que estamos a fazer com os camaradas. Como os camaradas sabem, Angola é essencialmente um país produtor de petróleo. Nós temos 80% das nossas exportações são de petróleo bruto. E o que corresponde a pelo menos a mais de 80% do orçamento geral do Estado são recursos oriundos do petróleo. Em 2014, o petróleo sofreu uma baixa significativa, tendo saído de mais de $150 para $35 o barril de petróleo. Isso, como deverão imaginar, afetou significativamente a estrutura econômica do país, o que fez com que a economia nacional entrasse num profundo processo de recessão por 6 anos consecutivos de crescimento negativo. E, portanto, com o camarada presidente João Lourenço assumiu uma postura de reforma das estruturas econômicas do país, tendo como lema a diversificação da economia, já que temos um país rico em recursos naturais, para além do petróleo. Então, poderíamos olhar para outros recursos e contendo a agricultura como base de sustentação do nosso programa de diversificação da economia. Ouço afirmar que Angola praticamente já não importa alimentos de produção agrícola. O processo de industrialização do país ainda não atingiu as metas que nós gostaríamos, mas o trabalho é contínuo neste sentido. Portanto, o Estado, hoje, voltamos, felizmente, a ter índices de crescimento econômico positivo. Temos as previsões do governo angolano, dão um crescimento de 3,2% do produto interno bruto para o próximo ano econômico. Sendo certo que o ano econômico transato de 2021, Angola já registrou um crescimento econômico acima de 2 pontos percentuais. Portanto, o que quer dizer que o processo que o partido está a conduzir está a seguir bom caminho. Para finalizar, gostava apenas de dar nota que o governo angolano, liderado pelo MPLA, tem um programa base de combate à fome e à pobreza, que tem essencialmente dois eixos. Um eixo de transferência direta de renda, um programa chamado Cuenta, que entrega pessoalmente a cada uma das famílias um valor trimestral para que elas possam sustentar-se e não saírem assim da dependência, ou melhor, da fome, objetivamente. O programa Cuenta e também há um outro programa que está em curso, que é o programa Plano Integrado de Intervenção dos Municípios, denominado PIM. Este programa é de construção de infraestruturas para potenciar o desenvolvimento, especialmente dos municípios rurais. Este programa está a ser aplicado em todos os municípios do país, que são 165 municípios, e estamos a ter, felizmente, resultados muito positivos. Para finalizar, no âmbito deste programa, nós produzimos a transposição do rio Cunene para levar água para o interior da província, através do chamado canal do Carro, e infelizmente não temos oportunidade, mas recomendo aos camaradas que possam ir à internet, ao YouTube, e pesquisarem o canal do Carro e ver como o rio Cunene foi transposto em mais de 170 km, um canal que leva água do rio para o interior da província do Cunene. Muito obrigado, camaradas.
Thank you very much once again for the opportunity to present the presentation of Swapo Party on behalf of the delegation of the party. And let me first and foremost extend our heartfelt appreciation to our fallen heroes and heroines that have fought for the total liberation of our continent, Africa. And as we are standing today, we can see that amongst all those heroes and heroines, we are only having one, Comrade President Sam Nujoma, who is still alive. Now, for that, I want to ask you for us to stand for a minute of silence for our fallen heroes and heroines that have sacrificed their life for the total liberation of our continent, Africa. Attention. Thank you very much. May we as all rest in eternal peace. Now, our assignment in conference is that our presentation is structured based on the theoretical innovation of governing practice, experience, and theoretical innovations. Now, the theoretical innovation of the Swapo Party is based on our aims and objectives in our party constitution. And I will share with you some of the aims and objectives of the Swapo Party. Objective number one, whereas the Namibian people emerged victorious from the struggle against colonialism, that the Namibia has taken its rightful place among the free nations of the world as a sovereign state, that the establishment of a democratic political system in our country has brought the role of political parties from the back of the banner to a premier place in our nation's political life. That the process of declaration of the Namibian society and the elimination of the previous remains of apartheid has been achieved. So, that the exploitation of one person by another person, for individual or class, including gender equality, is unacceptable and in an independent and democratic Namibia. As a party, we have infused our political program in our government progress. Then we have rules and procedures, it's a document of the party. That is the rules and procedures of the Swan Party. Then we have the Swan Party election manifesto, which is regarded as a contract between the party and the Namibian people. The manifesto says it's a contract between for 5 years. Now, in all these structures, when our leaders are elected, gender balance is a priority amongst our candidates. We must make sure if the chairperson of a branch or a section or a district is a male, now the secretary for another person must be a female. So why our gender balance in Namibia is very, very considered. Now, we as a party came to learn and we came to benchmark with other political parties, especially the parties that got their independence very earlier than Namibia, and to learn more from them. But we are also proposing that that follow-up workshops and trainings must be conducted in order for us to benchmark for the purpose of exchanging our programs. And we also propose that as liberation movement that has got their independence to support the liberation of the Western Saharan people. As our political party that got independent, I think our independence in us has been independent because of other African countries, so let us support the liberation of Western Sahara. Since we have been given only 10 minutes to share what we are having with the other political or liberation movements, I really don't want to take much time to share with you what we have, but if there is any need, I think the delegation of Namibia is available 24/7 from now. Get any information that you need. But let me also use this opportunity to extend our appreciation to the Republic of Angola in terms of supporting us and hosting us during our liberation struggle. And we also extend our appreciation and thanks to the Republic of Tanzania for hosting us and giving us training, the Republic of Zimbabwe for assisting us with the education. We have our people, engineers, and doctors that are from Zimbabwe, staying with the Republic of South Africa, our lecturers, our lawyers that we are having today within the Republic of Namibia, and got their education in South Africa. I also thank them for the support. I remember during the 1990 election, South Africa sent a group of cadres to come and support the independence of Namibia. And that we are indebted to you, and we remain indebted to our comrades and friends on the African continent. As a person who came from Mozambique, really more for their support to the liberation of Namibia. In short, that is our contribution towards the discussion that we are having. But if there is any other discussion or any question or anything, I think we are still open for any question. Thank you very much.
Opportunity to cross-pollinate ideas as revolutionary parties. It was very important in long overdue. Thank you very much. Asante sana. I want to recognize before I speak about our party, I want to recognize that when we are in Tanzania, we are home, because those who have read history, especially the Bantu migration, will notice that our genesis came from Uruguswa, which is around this place. That's why when someone speaks Swahili, there are some words that you can hear that are related to Shona. It means that we are one in East Africa. So when we are here, we feel pretty normal. When I see my brother from South Africa, when I see my brother from Angola, when I see my brother from Mozambique, when I see a sister from Tanzania, I see a fellow brother in Qatar. So we are one. Secondly, we are most happy that we are in a land which we call was Malindi. Tanzania is Malindi. When I say Tanzania is Malungu, Malungu means in Swahili the teacher. Tanzania, I'm looking at the role that they played in the liberation of Zimbabwe and other African states because of the deep rooted philosophy that Comrade Nyerere had, teaching and motivating other African countries to think. And he was doing this through. Three means, number one, providing areas for us to train, giving the moral support, so we are united about that. I come from a party which is called ZANU-PF, that's Zimbabwe African National Union Patriotic Front, which is one of the three parties which carries the name of this country in the name of the continent in one country. So, ZANU Zimbabwe African National Union Patriotic Front. It means and shows our deep-rooted pan-Africanism spirit in ZANU. That's the party that we have. It is a part of the liberation struggle in our collection of two revolutionary movements that ZANU and ZIPA, political parties. ZANU and PF, ZANU and the head of the unity in 1987. All these two parties were formed as a result of the liberation struggle when they were fighting against colonialism. In terms of the leadership, currently our president, His Excellency President Emmerson Mnangagwa, a product who of the predominance of the Mandela leadership of Julius Nyerere, who was trained here in Bangalore. He is currently our president, and we are happy that in our party we put leadership of the generation of the liberation struggle, those who fought against colonialism, and also a blending of those leaders. So we have those who fought in the liberation struggle. Whom we respect very much, the war of the 10 years. We have got the youth That is not even the liberation struggle. If we also have a generation that is going to participate in the liberation struggle. I also want to emphasize in Zambia, it also respects the aspects of women. Why do I say that? Because our national chairperson, who is part of the presidential, Madame Chikuni, is a woman and also a minister of defense. And now we are all the steps further to ensure that the aspect of men, that the land that has been given, is utilized. So our president is encouraging to make sure that you use in best productivity, that the farm that you have produced, so that you don't make the farm idle. Basically, what our president is saying, he's saying that the land is united by his people, in which some people are separated, which means that land before some people will continue to make sure that we want to change the land which is ours. That is the only response that we have. But we will now move a step further to make sure that we meet process. I also want to emphasize all aspects of reform. The party underwent a series of reform like any other party that happened. Around 2017, 2016, with a click of some who get elected from the principals of the revolution, we thought that the party belongs to individuals. So as a result, those things is around themselves are the former first lady, the same way which happened in China with the wife of President Mao in the game of war, trying to make sure that there was confusion within the party. So the central committee of the party set now and decided to make sure that those people are expelled. So we are happy, and the leadership is there trying to make sure that the party remains one. In 2023 next year, we are going for elections, and we just recently held our youth conference. I was the national youth leader, youth in the youth. So we held a transition to make sure that the youth leadership comes to the board of the youth sector. And we are happy that most of the congress came from CCM, from the ANC, but unfortunately we do not get some comments from Angola. But we want to thank those comments who came and supported us during our conference. We are also going to have the Women's Conference in June and the Congress, the Electric Conference, Congress, which is going to be held in October, to confirm the leadership of the International Nagawa as our sole presidential candidate for the 2023 election. I think I have some few minutes left. Let me just, 1 minute, let me just want to emphasize on the economic development and what is being done in as far as economic development is concerned. The philosophy encouraging a theological innovation that we are embracing as a party is one, the one which was used to deliver this struggle. That we are our own liberators. So we are saying a nation is built by its own. So what we are doing is that we are using local resources to develop our country. How are we doing this? The road that we are constructing, the causeway, the Bay Bridge Road, is being constructed by local companies using local resources, which is actually a departure from what used to happen in the old republic, where we would pour money and check for the companies to make roads for us. So we are happy with that. Number two, issue of electricity generation. We are also making sure that the thermal power systems that we use, that's Taiba 7, 8, building new thermal stations there, to ensure that we increase our capacity by the end of this year, we'll be able to more 600 megawatts in the electrical grid. Number three, we are also encouraging smart and green energy, where we are calling those who want solar and we have solar initiative projects, and they are also adding their capacities to the solar grid. So we are happy with what is happening, but it's very saying that development is not an event, it is a process. But we do believe that with the leadership of Zambia, which in 2030 will want everyone to become an upgrading of the economy by 2030. Be achievable through the ways of our men, because initiative is good planning. So thank you very much, Master. The first countries in Africa to have a single vice president under the guidance of Zanu-PF. So we had a vice president who was female, who was one of the first in Africa to have a female vice president in that position. So the vice president was not only vice president of the country, but she was the vice president of the country and the party altogether. So currently, as I have indicated, we have a national chairperson who is also a former, and she's also a minister of defense. So this shows our respect to the issue of equity and equality between women and men. But most importantly, internally, members of the Women's League, those who are with the WWE, which is called the Women's League, which is only a all-women affair, and 20 of those women, 20 heads of departments of the Women's League, are part of the Central Committee. The Central Committee is the highest decision organ outside Congress and conference. So 20 women are part of that organ. Then the youth, members of the National Executive Committee of the Youth League, 20 of them are also members of the Central Committee, which shows that internally, for that aspect of youth inclusion are in the decision-making organs of the party. I'll spend more day in the speaker of some of the aspects. I also want to emphasize the fact that as a party, we also went head in love with youth-led and women-led affiliation groups. These affiliation groups, they are centered on areas of the economy, social activism, and development. That's why we support such organizations like Mentally, the Women for Haiti, Zikosu, National Youth Service, and all of this, they share the main agenda of the party. And they will help us to mobilize the masses in certain specific areas. So this is some of the key aspects, some of the key parts of the and mobilization strategies that we use to mobilize. I also want to emphasize how the party influences the aspect of youth inclusion and women inclusion in government and also in other areas in local government. Number one, there was a constitutional amendment in Bill number 2, which was enacted, which requires that in parliament there are 10 reserved seats for youth, those who are not candidates in government. This doesn't mean that the youth won't contest in the other 210 positions. The 10 seats are actually a bonus, an added bonus to the election of the 210 seats, which are already existing. Number 2, we also have the women's quota with 160 women that are supposed to be their seats that are reserved to women in the parliament for women. 60 of them under the women quota system that we have. And this has also been expanded for more 10 years. So this is another way that we are including women in those aspects. Our president, because of his leading in the government, in 2018, he took those young people who managed to make it in parliament, and some that were not in parliament, to become ministers, cabinet ministers. So we have more than 60 youth that were appointed in cabinet as four ministers and some as deputies. So this is another thing that we have also benefited from the leadership of the party in this. Philosophies are coming from the past. Another popular thing that you might know is that Zimbabwe, under the leadership of Zanu-PF, is one of the first countries in Africa to reclaim the internet. You are aware that one key aspect that happened is that when the colonialism came, there were less than 20,000 of them, and they took 90% of the face of it. While more than 1.5 million of indigenous people did not own the land. So we took that in the next before around 2000, because we took that land, the Europeans were not able, they were not able, they were happy, they were angry and happy because of that, because we were fitting for the level form that we had.